You've been searching for the best way to generate passive income in your life and heard that real estate is a great way to do it. But you're tired of all the so-called gurus who are all talk and no substance. Get ready to celebrate because Kevin Bupp has spent 14 years successfully making it happen. This is the Real Estate Investing for Cash Flow podcast. Now, here's Kevin Bupp.
Hey guys, Kevin Bupp here, and I want to welcome you to another episode of the Real Estate Investing for Cash Flow podcast. Our mission is to help you build and maintain massive amounts of cash flow through income-producing real estate investments. And our guest for this week's show is a real estate investment expert, Evie Brooks. Now, Evie is a real estate investment educator, keynote speaker, investor, coach, mentor, entrepreneur, and former advanced trainer for Rich Dad, Poor Dad, who now specializes in all things Panama, including real estate and organic agricultural investments. With over 24 years of real estate investment experience, she's educated and guided thousands of investors through the process of locating, evaluating, analyzing transactions for cash flow and return on investment in 13 plus countries and 30 plus states in the United States. Now, during the global pandemic, Evie continues to close deals every week, primarily due to the soaring demand for organic farming investments in Panama, where 85% of the food is imported. So guys, I'm excited to introduce Evie to the show here, but before we dive into it with her, I have a few quick housekeeping items and updates to run through. The first one here, our latest and highly anticipated mobile home park investment fund recently went live and we're accepting capital, but I'll say that space is limited. Okay. So if you have an interest, definitely go check us out on our website, sunrisecapitalinvestors.com. And for those that don't know, this offering is a Regulation D 506C and it's open to all accredited investors. And for those that aren't familiar, maybe you're listening for the first time, not familiar with me and my team, we specialize in mobile home parks. We've been doing it for nearly a decade. I've been a full-time investor for nearly 20 years, but mobile home parks has been our specialty and primary focus for the last decade, way back before most investors even considered this amazing investment vehicle. Now I like to say that the secret is out, unfortunately, which is why big private equity firms such as Carlyle Group and Blackstone and Apollo Group, just to name a few of the big boys, they've jumped into the space. They've jumped in a very big way and are deploying, hundreds of million dollars of capital into this asset class. And so if you want to learn more about partnering with a, first-class team and one of the most historically proven asset classes to date, then head over again to our website, sunrisecapitalinvestors.com. Again, sunrisecapitalinvestors.com. And once you get there, just click on the Get Started button and fill out the short form and you can access our PPM and our offering memorandum. Moving on here, guys, if you love what we're doing here at the Real Estate Investing for Cashflow podcast and you haven't done so already, please subscribe to the show. That way you get notified when new episodes come out. And also, leave a rating or review if you haven't done so. That's how we get awesome guests like Evie on the show. So please do that if you haven't done so already. And then lastly, before we get onto it here, I just want to remind you of the free 30-minute phone call I offer each and every Friday afternoon. I set aside 2 to 3 different 30-minute time slots where you can basically schedule a call with me. There's no ulterior motives here. I won't try to sell you anything. This is simply a way for me to connect with my listeners. And I've been doing it now for 6 years. I've talked to hundreds of you over that time period. And doesn't matter whether you're brand new or a seasoned pro, I'd love to meet you and chat with you and talk about real estate investing. So you go to my website, kevinbupp.com, to get that call scheduled. And now, guys, without further ado, I'd like to welcome our guest for today's show, Evie Brooks. So Evie, how are you doing today?
I am great. How are you doing?
I'm doing awesome. Excited to have you here. Give a sense of geography, I know we're going to talk about all things Panama here today, but to give a sense of geography, where are you calling us from today?
I'm actually in Atlanta right now, waiting out the coronavirus situation in Panama, but they have opened back up yesterday and we are preparing to get back to Panama now.
All right, good. I was going to say, that didn't sound like a South American accent.
Not exactly. I can't even speak Spanish.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Good deal. Well, excited to chat with you here today about, investing abroad, more specifically in Panama. And so, but before we dive into it, maybe take a few minutes, Evie, and tell us a little bit more about yourself, your background. You've been doing this now for, 24 plus years. And so talk to us a little bit about, how you got started in real estate and ultimately how you landed investing abroad in ag products.
Well, it was kind of a fluke. I ended up in it right out of college by mistake. I was going on to law school and got really, really sick from being pregnant, unexpected first pregnancy. And so I ended up in commercial real estate management and asset management. And I stayed in corporate America for 4 years. I left there because I finally figured out after 4 years, I was on the wrong side of the desk. Everybody on the other side was making way more money than I was as independent investors and contractors and things like that. So I stepped out on my own. I started investing and I've never looked back since. And it's just expanded and it's gone from there. And then after doing that for several years, I was invited to be an educator with the Rich Dad Poor Dad organization and started out domestically as an elite trainer. Ended up doing their international investing training in Costa Rica. And that's how I ended up internationally. And after the big crash in 2008, I moved over to Panama in 2012, and the rest is history.
Wow. Okay. Good deal. Well, I'm going to back up a little bit because I want to see if we can add some more context here to that. I mean, again, you know, more than two decades of experience. Were most of your initial investments, were they residential investments? Were they commercial investments? Were they, you know, all across the board? But, you know, kind of where did you get your start?
Well, I first started in residential in my backyard right here in Atlanta, Georgia, in Forsyth County, Gwinnett County, Hall County. And then I started expanding out and getting into more areas. I went to Florida. I went to North Carolina, had projects there. And then when I started teaching domestically with the Rich Dad organization, I got into some projects in Utah and Missouri and North Dakota. I'm still in all of those except Missouri, several projects there, significant size projects. I started with single family homes. I expanded into development. And, you know, I've been all over the board, everything from fix and flips to development to lease options, you name it, pretty much every component that you can think of. Mm-hmm. As far as hands-on real estate type stuff, I've done commercial. And then when I started teaching with the Rich Dad organization in Costa Rica in 2003, I just got a bug for the international, the expat community and the expat market, because it's such a huge market. I thought it was big then. That was nothing compared to what it is now. And I've just stayed in that space. It's a niche market that very few people really understand or know. And most people are afraid of investing internationally. It's very simple. It's actually easier than it is to invest in the United States. And so I've just stayed in it ever since.
Okay, good deal. We're going to dissect that, you know, that it's easier than investing in the United States, but I don't want to go into that right now. But I want to ask you just, you know, how was it working with the Rich Dad Company? You know, I mean, it's a large organization.
Yeah, it was a lot of hard work. You were on the road pretty much from Thursday till Monday every week. And I enjoyed it, but it was really hard to run the rest of your business if you're truly a real estate investor, which I was. A lot of the educators didn't do a whole lot of real estate investing, but I did. And for me to run my business as well as be on your feet training all day, every day from 7 a.m. until 6 to 7 p.m. at night, 3 days every single weekend. It was hard work. I mean, people think it's a luxury lifestyle, but it's not, it's work. But I enjoy it because I really am an educator at heart. I love teaching others and showing other people how to be successful in real estate because it just runs in my blood. And that is my playground and I love what I do.
And so do you still do that today or no? Are you
I do not. No, I don't teach with the Rich Dad organization. Okay. I do mentor very few. I'm very selective on the clients that I will mentor. And most of my clients have been with me for over 10 years, 10 to 15 years. So I do have mentor clients that I work with. And I do a lot of real estate educational training in Panama. I'll have 3-day what we call VIP boot camps. And so people will come in and they'll go on that 3-day tour. And it's all things Panama, everything from getting your visa to setting up a Panamanian entity or corporation, if you want to do that, setting up bank accounts, investing internationally, and the strategies that go with the different types of investment projects that we do in Panama.
Okay, fantastic. So leads me to the next question. You know, why Panama? Out of all the other different, you know, Central and South American countries, why'd you choose Panama?
That is going to be the easiest question that you're going to ask me today. And the answer is the Panama Canal and now the Cobre Copper Mines, because the GDP is so strong. Even after 2008 crash, in 2009, the Panama GDP dropped all the way down to 4%. And it's been at well over 9% with an average of over 6% from 2010 until 2020, until coronavirus hit. And so you've got so much growth, so much opportunity, so much multinational interest. And it's not just a tourism-only country. In fact, tourism ranks about number 5 on the list of priorities in Panama. And so you're not locked into this is just a tourism investment. And if tourism crashes like it did with coronavirus or in 2008, you're stuck because you've got so many other avenues. You've got the central banking consolidated right in Panama for, you know, the world. There is, it's one of the largest banking districts in the world. It's like what Switzerland used to be. You've got, you know, the Cobre copper mines, which are projected to bring in more revenue in the next 40 years than the Panama Canal itself. So, and that's just opened up and just started in the last couple of years. So you've just got so many different avenues. You've got the multinational companies that are being lured into Panama because of all the perks and the benefits and the tax benefits that they offer to them. And so you've got a lot of multinational companies that have come and will continue to come. And now Panama is even working on a brand new visa that's going to be more exciting and more enticing to everybody worldwide.
Okay. No, that's great. I appreciate that. And you know, what would lure somebody that is based in the US to invest abroad when there's, you know, seemingly endless opportunities here in the US to invest in? I mean, you know, obviously you got to understand the basic foundations and principles of real estate investing. And that's, you know, let alone that's enough in the US just to figure out and to do successfully, let alone, in, you know, learning the skill sets needed to invest in a foreign country. And so why would someone, you know, be lured away from the US to place their capital into Panama?
Primary reason is diversification. Okay. So many people through coronavirus and what's happening in the United States, not only the United States, Germany, South Africa, Israel, you name it, are calling saying, I have to get some of my funds, some of my assets out of this country. They're very concerned about what's happening, what's going to happen as a result of all of the fiat printing of money. So the diversification is the number one reason. A lot of people just want to downsize. They want to have a simpler lifestyle, but the quality of lifestyle that they become accustomed to for, you know, a less expensive cost, depending on where they're from, and the ability to be in a warm tropical environment, the opportunity to live and let live. You don't have a whole lot of government intervention and being told you can do this and you can't do that. It's pretty much a very easygoing lifestyle. So there's many different reasons, but those are the primary.
Got it. And you shared the, you know, the big benefits of Panama versus some of the other, you know, solely tourism driven countries. You know, before we started recording, we talked about some of your time in Costa Rica and ultimately what occurred there due to it being strictly a tourism driven country. You know, are there other countries that offer opportunities similar to Panama, or is Panama the one that kind of takes priority out of most?
Well, there are other countries. Of course, you've heard about Belize and Portugal and Greece and all these other places that people want to go to. And a lot of it is people are just looking for a forever home. They want to go to the area that they want to live in retirement. But for the most part, you have a number of different attractions to the Panama market that prevail over Ecuador or, you know, some of these other ones that are just true third world countries. And people don't want to feel like they're in no man's land, and they get there and it's not what they thought, and they're unhappy and they're not in community, and it's just so different. Where Panama is very similar to any metropolitan city, Panama City itself, that you're going to go into. The skyline's very similar to what you're going to see in Chicago or Atlanta or Dallas. You've got all the same quality of shopping and fine dining. So you can have that standard of living that you're accustomed to, or you can get out into the third world type of environment, or you can go back and forth between the two and experience both. But you have the options. And, you know, the cost of living there, you've got the ability to have businesses, start businesses and be very successful there, mm-hmm. because you've got enough of a population to have all kinds of different demands, where in some of these other countries, you're just not going to have that. Belize and Ecuador and places like that.
Got it. So let's talk about the type of investments that you're involved in Panama, which is in the agricultural world. Give us a little bit more of a background as to exactly the different types of ag investments and you know, why that particular sector.
Well, ag is an afterthought. You know, when we first started, it was simply for the expats that's wanting to move there or have investments in pre-construction, condominiums, single family type things, all kinds of different strategies that we use there, like senior living, medical tourism, where they have a plan A, plan B, plan C, and we always have multiple exit strategies in case something like coronavirus happens. Mm-hmm. But several years back, I got into the ag side of things after sitting on the sidelines and watching for a long time, because I've been one of those that have taken the arrows that have taken me down. And so I wanted to watch and see, because this concept was new in Panama. It's called a reverse co-op. And now you've got multiple companies that's doing it because of the huge success with the original company that started there that I work closely with. And I work with several of them, not only in Panama now, but in multiple different countries with the ag, because a reverse co-op concept is I can be a farmer without ever having to go hoe a row. And I can get the lion's share of the return on investment with somebody else that has dozens of years, combined over 100 years of experience in the agricultural industry and the high tech industry, in the organics, the hydroponics, the aquaponics, the drip technology. So you've got all that going for you. Somebody that really knows what they're doing, they're doing all the heavy lifting and you're just making the profit from it. And so after watching it and seeing some, a lot of investors really happy with the returns that they were seeing on this, I was like, this is a really good opportunity, because food is going to become more and more in demand. Land, arable land, is becoming less and less available, and therefore creating a higher value for that land. So it just was a no-brainer.
Explain the mechanics of a co-op and how that works for those. I understand the basic premise of a co-op, but how does it work in an investment sense in one of these ag investments?
Okay, co-op and reverse co-op. Co-op is what most people in the ag business or industry know. And that a co-op is where a big broker that has accounts around the world with like the Whole Foods of the world and the HEBs and that kind of stuff. They have the accounts. And so they go out and find farmers, smaller farmers collectively, let's say in Peru, that are growing, but they don't have the connections nor the volume to be able to deal with these big boys. So this broker, this middleman, will come in and he'll co-op with all those small farmers to buy the food from them, and then they carry it on and ship it and take it out to the world. So that's a co-op. Well, Panama didn't have enough farmers to even do that. Panama had very, very incredibly wonderful arable land that had not been used for farming, just for running cattle and goats and sheep and things like that through the years. And so they came in 15, 20 years ago and started purchasing up this land quietly, hundreds, thousands of hectare of land. And then they started this reverse co-op where they would find people that wanted to be farmers or invest in the farm industry that could purchase as little as 1 hectare of land that they would then in turn lease back and farm the land for you with a management agreement, with a land agreement. So you've got a farm management agreement where they're going to manage that land for you, and they're going to take a 30% profit and you're going to take a 70% profit. So it's a reverse co-op concept, and it has just taken off now because of the success of the original company. Multiple other companies are doing the same thing, not only in Panama, but in other countries as well.
And does the individual, the investor, do they have the same protections as one might have here in the U.S. of, in a typical syndication type arrangement where a limited partner is ultimately a member of that LLC, a proportionate member of the LLC? Does it work in a similar manner to where that investor has protection, ownership rights of that property? Or
you have you receive title to the property, very simply stated. And
you're just buying a section? I mean, do you actually get a dedicated section? Or
yes, absolutely. You have the coordinates of your exact piece of plot of land. You own that plot of land. And then when they build it, clear it, put the irrigation in, plant the trees, that's yours. It's yours forever. You can pass it on to your beneficiaries. You can sell it. You can sell it as a business. You can keep it and just continue to receive the revenues from the production, but it's just like buying a piece of land here in the United States.
Do most of these reverse co-ops, are they already operational farms? So where if I'm going to, invest into, whatever predetermined amount of hectares, I mean, is it already producing, or is it, I make my investment, now that company goes and cultivates that land, puts the irrigation, what have you?
No.
Okay.
The farms are producing, but not the ones that are being sold for the future. That's raw land. And they just keep selling it in the next contiguous piece to the next person that comes in. And then they go in and clear it and plant it. But they're not actually planting and doing that, because right now we're at over 5,000, I think it's over 5,000 hectare. And so we just continue to add on to that existing land in a continuous space to connect to the last irrigation that was on the last sold plot, mm-hmm. to continue that forward. So your trees are actually growing in the greenhouse right now, but your land has not been cleared and the irrigation's not put in until the piece of land is sold.
Where I'm going with that question is, once an individual makes an investment, how long is it typically before they start seeing dividends paid out on that investment?
Exactly. 4 years for the outdoor crops, which are trees, hardy trees, because it takes the trees, you have to plant them, grow them, start producing. So 4 years, you anticipate getting your first payout. Now, if you're in the greenhouse, which we have what we call hydroponics in the greenhouses, that's a 2-year turnaround. And there's strengths and weaknesses, pros and cons in both, depending on, you know, what your interests are. And so somebody has to sit down and evaluate the two different kinds of concepts side by side and look at what they like better. A lot of people like the fact that they get paid out in 2 years and that you're inside a controlled environment and the crops are just going to continue to go. And you can switch from one crop to another. You can go from melons to cucumbers or from cucumbers to tomatoes, depending on what's in the greatest demand in the greenhouse. However, you don't own the actual land under your portion of the greenhouse. Where if you have the trees, you have a whole hectare, which is 2.47 acres of land that you get in addition to the trees. The trees are going to produce for 50, 60, maybe 70 years. The greenhouse is basically an investment into a greenhouse operation, and you've got a 30-year contract on that. Both are going to produce somewhere between a 13 and 15% internal rate of return, or 15 to 17% is the projections based on historical numbers.
Determined over what span of time when you give that IRR number? Is that over
30 years?
Okay.
30 years.
Okay, got it. And then what types of crops are we talking about? When you say trees, what's the more common crop or tree that we're speaking to?
You have avocados, limes, mangoes, passion fruit, pineapple. These are all outside crops. Bananas, plantains. I mean, and some of them are rotational crops and some of them are perm crops. And then inside the greenhouses, you would have things like I mentioned, melons, berries, cucumbers, peppers, tomatoes, things like that. And so it's two completely different types of production.
Okay. And then are 100% of these crops, distributed throughout just Panama alone, or is there an export business as well associated with it?
We are anticipating that in about 7 or 8 years, we will be exporting to the rest of the world. But right now, okay. The demand is so strong in Panama that 85% of the food required to feed the Panamanian population has to be imported into Panama.
Wow.
So there's such a need in Panama that fortunately our food can stay right there in Panama right now. But we're anticipating, based on our projected growth and the demand for food, that in 7 to 8 years, we will start shipping from the Panama Canal. So we can harvest today and ship today. Harvest today, ship tomorrow, right from the Panama Canal, which saves a lot of time. Because when you start shipping overseas across the pond, you've got to be concerned about spoilage and the amount of time that it takes to get from one country to the next country. Sure. So that's the good thing about where we are in Panama right now. There's such a demand in Panama, we cannot keep up with the demand of food required in Panama.
Got it. That's a good problem to have, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah. At least from the investment side, right? How about conducting business in Panama? Talk about that. I mean, is it a business friendly place? I mean, are there any specific risks or pitfalls that one should understand and know about going into it?
I have multiple entities. Mine are called SA, Sociedad Anonymous. It's a type of business. It's very similar to an LLC in the United States. And you can also have an LLC in Panama. But mine is structured because of the different types of anonymity, which, you know, asset protection is very important for me. Being with the Rich Dad organization, working with Garrett Sutton throughout the years, asset protection is just a real strong component of everything that we do. So that's why I went that route. But it's very simple. It's very inexpensive. We have the whole power team put together for everything from setting up the LLCs to having the local agencies or the SAs, whichever type of entity you want, to, you know, being your local agent, to maintaining, managing your CPAs and everything that you could possibly need, if that's something you need or want. Mm-hmm. I will tell you, most people do not need to have a Panamanian entity if they have for example, United States LLCs in the United States, they put their property from Panama in their U.S. LLC, unless they're wanting to become a true expat and, you know, relinquish their U.S. citizenship, and then they would want to set up a Panamanian entity.
Got it. No, understood. And then talk to me about the tax side of things. I mean, the actual, are there any tax benefits associated? And I mean, do they, again, I've never had this discussion, and I don't own any investments abroad, but do you still gain the same tax benefits of owning this real estate as you might here in the U.S.?
Better. For example, like if you're in the ag industry in Panama, you have $350,000 per year of no taxable obligations to Panama. Now, if you're still a citizen in another country and you have tax obligations and liabilities in those countries, then those are still in play in your home country. We can't change that. But in Panama, like if you bought a condo in or a home in a particular government appointed investor type of a project, they have anywhere from 5 to 10 to 15 years, no property taxes. A lot of the businesses that come into the different districts like Panama Pacifico, which used to be the Howard Air Force Base, or Costa del Este, there's several areas of Panama that's designated for international business. And if you have your business set up and structured in those areas, then you have all kinds of tax benefits and tax perks that you would not have otherwise. So it's expansive as far as the number of different options and opportunities, depending on what you're wanting to do. And they continue to expand upon that. During the coronavirus, they have been working on some new programs that are going to be even more enticing than what they already had. So we're excited to hear what that's going to be and when that comes out.
Got it. How about depreciation? Is there anything to depreciate with a farm? And, you know, do any of the, you know, the members of that co-op, do they proportionally get their share of, I don't know if you can depreciate the irrigation, or I guess that's really the only component. I don't know if there's other aspects of it, but anyway, I'll let you speak to that if there's any benefits there.
Actually, I can't because I'm not a certified public accountant or CPA financial planner, so I'm not allowed to be able to have those conversations, but I can put you in touch with the people that can address those for you. But I'm not, I have been instructed and told that's just not enough. Something I can actually provide advice on.
Fair enough. How has the investing activity changed during this pandemic? I mean, have things slowed? I know you said you received more interest, but just, Has it placed a burden on your company, and how have you guys been working through that over these last 6 or so months when, again, as we talked about before we started recording, Panama just opened up to allowing, you know, folks from the U.S. to travel back over there. And so it's been, you know, many months of dealing with not being able to visit. So how has that played out in your business? Any major changes that you've...
It's been almost 7 months. And so... It's changed the world, but we've figured out how to do it. You know, it was a challenge to begin with. We were like, what do we do? And, you know, Zoom has become a huge component of our business. So we have virtual conferences. And I mean, I've been doing virtual conferences, like 3-day conferences all around, you know, the world. And we have people interested in everything that you can possibly imagine, but more so people that have been furloughed, lost their jobs, they're scared to death, they're fed up, they're wanting out of their areas, that are like purchasing condominiums sight unseen and investments in the ag because they're wanting to move their money into an offshore type of safe haven. That's how they perceive it. And it truly is. I mean, just truly diversifying, getting international, have their assets tied up in other things that are tangible instead of things that can just like disappear, stocks and bonds and things like that overnight, because you just don't know what's going to happen and people just don't know what to expect. None of us do. We don't have a crystal ball. We don't know what the future holds. So this puts something in a tangible asset that is an income producing asset. I mean, food. The United Nations is projecting that the demand for food is going to increase to 8.5 billion by 2030. I mean, that's a huge jump from where we are right now. And then by 2050, it's going to be almost, you know, another 70% demand for food over what we produce right now. And so this is never going to go out of style. It's not something that people do not need any longer. It is going, it's not a fad. They're going to continue to need food. And so that is a big reason that we have so many people investing in the agriculture. And then, of course, you know, I have people that's like, you know, I was supposed to retire in 3 years. I got furloughed. I'm not going back. As soon as they open the doors, I am going to Panama. People purchase their units sight unseen, and they are on their way to Panama in the next 30 days to relocate. So you have just a combination of a lot of different things happening.
Got it. And what's a typical minimum size investment that's required to get involved in a space such as this?
Well, minimum investment and purchase price are two different things, because with a lot of our projects, you have like pre-construction where you can put down 10% now, 10% in a year, 10% in 2 years. So you can get in with as little as, you know, $18,000 to $25,000. Mm-hmm. For this year, and then the same amount again in the next year and 2 years. As far as the ag, the minimum investments start around $44,000 to $50,000. So depending on the fruit and the project that you're in, $44,000 to $50,000. And then, of course, you've got, you know, things all the way up to, you know, a full greenhouse would be $1.5 million. As little as $50,000 for just a fractional ownership in that greenhouse. So you've got a spread all over the board.
Are there insured protections in place should that, you know, that particular crop have a bad year, or maybe an infestation of bugs, or, you know, just something odd happens to where?
Yes, you've got different types of insurance options that you're capable of purchasing for your farms. Absolutely.
Okay. Got it. Good deal. Evie, what else? Are there any other, you know, important relevant items that we might have missed here as it relates to investing in Panama type investments, more specifically ag investments in Panama?
Well, as far as the ag, I mean, we've really covered that well. And, you know, like I said, there's ag investment opportunities, and we are constantly coming out with new options and new projects, constantly looking for new stuff as far as new opportunities for our investors, because the food, the agricultural investments is a hot commodity, and people are very, very interested in that. But then, of course, you've got, you know, the pre-construction, get in, get out. I've got a project that you get in and get out within 24 months, and you make 11% return in the first 12 months, guaranteed. You get that 11% return on month 12. And you'll get out of that project within 12 to 24 months. And that's a $50,000 project. It's a government subsidized housing program. So where the government's building homes for Panamanians that are in a certain economic level, that have had a job for 2 years, and you know, their monthly payments divided into two payments at $72, $73 a month. Every two weeks for a home. A nice little 500-600 square foot home. And so this is a hand up, not a handout for Panama. It's a government backed program. They get a preferred interest program substantially lower than what we even have here in the United States right now. So it's a very enticing program. And then you've got, you know, pre-construction with high end stuff, like the U projects, which are known worldwide. A new U is being built in Panama right now, and being able to get in, the developer will profit share with you. And depending on one of three different programs, they'll sell it right before completion and y'all split the profit. He takes 10 or 15% and you take 90 or 85, depending on your down payment. Hmm. Just all kinds of different strategies. I mean, we don't have a one size fits all. We have many different programs and projects because no one investor is going to be the same. They're going to have different needs and different demands. So we focus on each individual person.
Got it. Well, that's fantastic. I appreciate that. And you know, Evie, we've covered a lot of ground here today. Lots of golden nuggets have been shared. But if you just had one final golden nugget of advice or wisdom that you could leave with our listeners that might inspire and motivate them as they progress in their own real estate investing career, what would that one last golden nugget be?
Well, this is one I've been teaching for many years, and it applies anywhere. You can drop me into the middle of no man's land with no money in my pocket, and I could go build a real estate empire. And that is, the money is made in the buy, not the sell. That means that you don't pay full price for anything real estate related. Real estate is cyclical. You're going to have your ups and you're going to have your downs. You got to be selling when everybody else is buying and buying when everybody else is selling. You have to know the different strategies to know what strategies to use now. The strategies that I'm using right now are not the strategies I was using in January of this year. I'm telling you, it has changed. And so, in other words, I may not be looking for a vacation rental right now. I may be looking for more of a long-term type of a rental project if I'm looking for that. or something in ag, something that's going to produce on an ongoing basis, no matter what happens. So that would be the type of a golden nugget that I would throw out there. And there's three streams of income, and you want to make sure that you've got two of the three in every deal that you do, at least. And that does not include capital appreciation, because we have zero control over that. Mm-hmm. That is walking into equity in the buy, number one. Number two, having a cash flow option or opportunity once you own that property. And number three, forced appreciation. Can I force appreciation in this project? And if so, if I have two of those three things in any transaction, it's a no-brainer for me.
Yeah, no, that's great advice. And it probably ages me by referencing this, but you know, the whole, you know, the drop me in any city across the United States, Mayor the Robert G. Allen, way back in the day. I forget, No Money Down, I think was his very first book. Again, he's like one of the old school gurus from many, many, many years back.
Oh, but, yeah.
He had like a newspaper follow him around. I forget where he got dropped off. I can't recall, but that's what he did. And basically,
that's funny. That's a blast from the past. I haven't heard that name in a long time.
Yeah. Yeah, I just saw someone post a picture of him on Facebook the other day. Like, they literally had him at their conference. I mean, he's got to be in his, I would think, probably late 60s, early 70s now. But in any event, yeah, he's old school. So, Evie, it's been a lot of fun having you. Really appreciate it. Tell our listeners how they can learn more about you and what you've got going on. What's the best website to find you?
EvieBrooksPanama.com. There's an 11-minute video there that will talk a lot about our VIP tours. I believe in boots on the ground, coming and seeing. Of course, we do have a lot of sight unseen purchases and investments, but we really like education, and I am an educator, as I've mentioned. I love doing these three-day trainings, and it will talk about that on there, and it'll talk about some just basic real estate investment strategies in Panama. So that would be a great first place to go. Evie Brooks Panama. And that is spelled E-V as in Victor, I-E, Brooks, B-R-O-O-K-S, Panama.com.
All righty. Good deal. Evie, that's all we have. Thank you again for joining us. It's been so much fun.
All right. Thank you for having me.
All righty, guys. Well, that's all we have for this week's show. So until we meet again next week, this is your host, Kevin Bupp, wishing you huge success. You take care.
Congratulations. Now you've got more of the best tricks of the trade in building massive amounts of passive income from real estate. For more amazing resources, visit realestateinvestingforcashflow.com, and we'll see you next Monday morning.